Hey, what's up, everyone? Thank you for joining us once again at our SB Nation home on YouTube. This is Bib51, aka the Back in Blue video podcast. Like I said, thank you for joining us. I'm your host, Nick Hansen, and it's been a tough week for Blue Jays fans. Andrew Hendricks, Reid Price, how you doing, boys?
I'm sad, man.
I'm very sad also, actually. I was a little bit miserable. I think that was one of the words I was going to use. Mm-hmm. But we won today, so I mean, I guess I'm feeling a little bit better.
It's tough.
Drew, you're biting your lip.
I'm all right.
You all right?
I'm doing okay. Yeah, they're losing. Man. What are you gonna do about it, man?
I like your attitude.
Losing sleep. Man.
You're losing sleep, yeah. It's been, like I said, it was a tough week for Blue Jays fans. Edwin joined the 500 club. Let's just point that out at the top of the show. Congrats to him. He went up to the 500 level with a bomb. Very cool.
14th person ever to do it, I believe. They said
16th.
16th.
I believe it was 16th. Last Blue Jay to do it was Vernon Wells.
Nice. I thought it was 14th as well, but
I think it's 16th, and I think Shelley Duncan was the last guy with the innings. I was at that game.
Yeah. All right, fair enough. Nice.
Well, we're at it. Canseco and Phelps, they've gone up multiple times. Guys. You know.
If we were live, we'd get someone to tweet us right now, too, though.
Yeah, that's true. We're not live. Did I not say that already? Yeah, unfortunately, we're not live yet, but we're working on that. Anyhow, let's dive right into Jay's Trending. So, first off, I think we need to point out on May 2nd, which was a couple days ago, we were 10 and a half games out, and I think we are still sitting 10 and a half games out. Very disappointing. What to do?
Go ahead, Drew.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, he's throwing it to it right away.
Stop pressing and start having fun. I hate to kind of quote sample size here, but today, Sunday, the guys looked like they were having fun playing baseball.
That was nice to see.
And I don't think they've had a lot of fun this year, and let's be honest, it hasn't been fun for us fans either. But really, just go out there, don't grip the bat so tight, see what you can do. Guys like Moro, guys like Encarnacion, their last two wins, you know, teams really jumped on these guys' backs. And I think you can benefit from success around you when the team's struggling the way it is right now. So just go out there and have fun.
Yeah, it seems pretty easy to say it like that, and it should be simple to do. Now, DeRosa called a team meeting this week. Reid, you've been on some higher level ball than me. Have you ever had some team meetings?
Oh, yeah.
You've been a part of one, like a good, solid team meeting where you really aired it out?
Yeah, absolutely. Not me personally, like doing all the talking, but I've been called out before, actually, personally, in like kind of closed door serious meetings.
Yeah. I've been called out before, too.
For both hockey and baseball.
Yeah, it's all about being on part of a team, right?
Yeah, but I've been a part of some of those meetings where it's time to turn the ship around, and you get a different sense through those meetings. It's kind of like, not necessarily lighting a fire under your butt, but it's having those closed door meetings where you get the impression that they're serious tones and they're not normal. This is something out of the norm. And the tone of the meeting is serious. People get called out. People are asked to rise up to the occasion. I think you get a sense that, let's kind of right this ship. This is serious. Something's going wrong. Let's make the right turn here. So they can definitely help.
Definitely. But now, do you think that's what happened to the Blue Jays? Because I hear that, now DeRosa called it, which is he's a utility infielder. So I don't know if he's necessarily the guy that should be calling it. Of course, he was brought here for his veteran leadership. So I guess that partly gives him the role to do so. But do you think, from what I hear, there wasn't much calling each other out?
Yeah.
So do you think, from what happened, do you think it's going to help turn the ship around? Or?
Well, who knows, really? I mean, it's interesting. I think I've said it several times on the podcast now, closed door meeting. I mean, what else are you going to do? People ask, what are you going to do to right this ship? In my opinion right now, there's not much. It's kind of like it's up to the Jays to do it. You know, Farrell might bump the lineup around a little bit here and
Gibbons.
There. But Gibbons. Gibbons might mess up, bump around the lineup a little bit. That's hilarious. But these closed door meetings, I think, are important. I don't know if they could change the ship around, but it's something that I believe needs to happen. Now, I grew up playing a lot of hockey and a lot of baseball. There's a difference in intensity there, with intensities on the ice and off the ice. Sometimes in baseball, you bring an intensity and it might not work as well as it could in hockey because it's a faster paced game. So I find myself having a hard time balancing what is best when I consider baseball and hockey the two sports that I know the best. But I don't, without going on too far now, I don't know if it can help. But I think that they're absolutely necessary. And it's like, let's see if this helps.
Kind of thing. Because, I mean, we still have to find out from the play on the field.
Right.
Now, Drew, obviously we got the big W today. But do you think that was more to do with who we were facing with Saunders on the hill? Do you think it's the fact that, maybe they've got a little bit of a light spark underneath of them and they're going?
It could be a number of things, really. I mean, Saunders, historically has pitched pretty well in Toronto. Now, mind you, those are four game sample size, all you want to read into that. But no, I think today's game was punctuated by a couple of performances, one of them being DeRosa's. And if you're gonna call a team meeting, you're gonna want to lead by example. And like you said before, this guy's is a bench guy who's brought in as your glue guy and all that. But he really went out there and got himself into some good counts today. Got some good pitches to hit, and just really led by example. So
I guess he's doing his job then, right? I mean, you come in, he's getting the opportunity to play, and he's taking advantage of it.
That's what you got him for, really. I mean, you really. At the end of the day, everybody's going to call him a glue guy, and that's exactly what he is with his age. He's not going to see a lot of playing time, but it's what he does with his playing time that's going to benefit him. And like some of the other guys, I just think he's getting himself, you know, into better hitters counts at this point. I think we saw a lot of that today.
Yeah, I mean, of course, everyone started off slow. The numbers are horrible. We're going to go over that a little bit later on. But I think part of it may be the fact that Gibby's been all over the place. Now, you mentioned Reid. He's going to be changing up the lineup, but he's been changing it up, like, repeatedly. This week, he mentioned that Lind, he was put in the two-hole. He's going to stay there for a while. The next day, Melky's in the two-hole, and he's going to stay there for a while. Right? Yeah. So, I mean, is it that we can't trust Gibby? Is it that Gibby can't make up his mind? Is it that he doesn't need to tell us what he's doing every single day?
Well, he doesn't need to tell us what he's doing every single day, number one. He can't read into that too much because the lineup is going to change often. And I believe he's got to, I think I mentioned this before on a podcast, he's got to put the team in the best position to win. I think if he's kind of sitting on his laurels and letting them just go out there and do what they're supposed to do, it might look bad on him. With the simple fact that they're not winning very much, so he's got to do something to show that he's making an effort, just for the management, if you ask me, for the boys upstairs watching him. He's got to make these moves to try to get the best out of this team. He can't just sit back. It just wouldn't be very conducive to his job, if you ask me. But I think number one, he doesn't have to tell us too much what he's doing. Kind of sit on it a little bit more, because he might get over criticized.
Yeah, and now, Drew, do you like his lineup change-up, how he's shuffling it all the time? Do you like Lind in the two-hole, Melk in the two-hole?
Well, Lind's your best on-base guy right now. If you want guys to be on base for your sluggers and Batista and Edwin, hopefully there's going to be a guy on base when they lose the ballpark, though, when they take it out of the yard. I don't know if the switch or if what he said to the media, I don't know how far you can really read into that. I mean, at the end of the day, he's going to want to play whoever he feels personally is going to be the best matchup in that situation. And again, we go back to the platoon style of baseball, and you just want to give your team a chance to win, just like Reid said last week. That's why I can't really read too far into the constant switching around in the lineup. I mean, there may be a little bit more of it this year than we've seen in the past, but again, this is a team that's pressing. And like the team players that are pressing, like the ball players themselves, Gibby's going to be pressing for results as well. And I think that seeing so many different lineup types and styles so far this season is really a byproduct of him just trying to figure out what's going on and him trying to right the ship himself, which is a tough job to do and nobody's in.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, he can't be to blame because, I mean, he's putting the players in the position to succeed and they're not succeeding. I mean, he's working the bullpen pretty well. He's a work in the lineup. I mean, you can't complain that Dave is hitting leadoff one day, Laurie's hitting the next, Colby's in the 2-0 one day. He's got to shake it up. No one's doing anything out there. And I mean, you know, wasn't Colby hitting two when he had three hits this week? I think he was in the two spot. And the rest of the team came up lame, right? So, I mean, guys have to produce and they have to do it as a group. And I think we discussed this last week also. It starts with the starting pitching. And starting pitching has been struggling again. I mean, they're barely getting past, today actually Romero or Moro went into the eighth inning. But guys aren't getting out. Yeah, finally. First starting pitcher to do so. But guys aren't getting to the fourth, fifth, sixth innings. They're struggling. Too many walks. Home runs. Dickey gave up three home runs there the other day. What can we do with the starting pitching? I just glossed over the fact that Romero returned.
Yeah, I know. I heard you almost slipped the name Romero out. I was like, yeah, I remember that.
Sorry. I mean, maybe we should let off with
that. That's unexpected.
There's so much to
talk about. I think the first thing I'll just say quickly about the pitching, and I always like to preface my pitching talk with I'm not a pitcher and actually don't know too much about pitching, but those walks got to go down. Bombs Killers. Happen, you know, that means the guys are hopefully they're not missing over the plate on all of them, but the walks got to go first and foremost. But let's jump right into Romero, man.
Yeah,
he's
I think
back.
These are a little... Well,
yeah, good for him. Good for him. Yeah, I mean, he gets it. He shouldn't be here yet. We all know that.
That's the thing. He shouldn't necessarily
but, I mean,
be here.
But he's here, and you know, he had a good three innings, and then things blew up in the fourth. But I mean, good for him for being back, even though it's under circumstances why he's back. So that's kind of a...
He's here, though. I mean, you got to feel good for the person.
Well, I'm pulling for him big time, man. I haven't pulled for a Jays player like that in quite some time, you know.
I think everyone is. I mean, even more than Travis Snyder. Everyone wanted him back. I mean, of course, Ricky's been a lot more valuable to the franchise than Snyder as well. But
It actually reminds me a little bit of how I was pulling for Aaron Hill when he was struggling after having such a big season.
Yeah.
And, man, there's been several Jays over the years, though, that have just went...
It's baseball, though, right? That's why it's a great sport, because you never know what's going to happen. Not because guys plummet and burn.
It is, man. I'm not going to say that horrible quote again, but it really is. Like, it's you just never know. It's a strange sport, man.
Yeah, so, Drew, how was Ricky looking? Obviously, he sailed through the first three, but he struggled in the fourth.
Was it his
mental game?
You know what? He led off the fourth inning with a walk, and that was his first walk of the game. And I think I was keeping track of it because I was there at the game. I think that was the second full count or three ball count he got himself into and just made a bad pitch. And I remember everybody sitting around me was kind of saying, you know, well, he made it through the first nine pretty good, but just wait, let's see if they start making adjustments the second time through the batting order. And they did, and they started laying off a lot more of his stuff, and it inevitably turned into a couple of walks. But I think he just kind of came out of his delivery. He wasn't as snappy to the plate. There were a number of things that happened with Romero during that game, but overall, it wasn't a bad performance until the third, and that's going to happen when a guy's still battling mentally out there.
Now that you were, since you were live, what was the vibe in the stadium? Like, it was, how was the crowd reacting to Ricky, not just the first three, but the fourth, once he started struggling? Because I actually didn't get a chance to watch. So were the fans on him for getting up a couple walks, or they were supporting him? What was the vibe?
You know what? The fans were incredible. They were really in his corner that night, and it was something that I didn't expect. Yeah. I thought a lot of people were, well, here we go again, right?
Yeah.
And but no, there was a lot of fan support, and I think you could hear that on the field and feel that as well.
Yeah.
And it was a pleasant surprise considering the way the fan base has been so far this year.
No doubt, and I think the only reason he came out was actually because he got a liner off his arm.
That's right.
And he has a bit of a knot on his forearm. He took a one or two hopper off there.
Yep.
Yeah, that never feels good to hit. We could hit right on the muscle.
Hot shot.
It was a hot one. So unfortunately, he's a little tender. I think he'll be back next game. And what do we do? I guess it's too hard to look ahead now because we don't even know what's up with JJ. Johnson's on the DL. But what could we do when he comes back? I mean, do you think Ricky, like, something's going to have to happen? Do we just wait till that happens and not even ponder it right now? Or
you mean see if
Ricky
like
goes six starters.
Gets sent right back down?
Yeah, does he go down? Does he go to the bullpen? Does what happens?
Well,
does Hap get kicked out even though he's been pitching great?
Yeah, I don't know. I guess we see what happens with Johnson, see when he comes back, if it actually ends up being around 15 days or
monitor
what.
That situation.
That's big time there, so we'll get to see a sample size from Ricky. So if it's a starter too, I don't think we'll see him up staying unless they're really, really solid.
Yeah.
But if they're more, I don't know. I think he's still got more work to do, really. What do you think, Andrew?
I think it's going to be performance-driven, and Gibbons is obviously at this point in the season, given the rough start, he's going to be forced to play the hot hand.
Yeah.
And that being said, if Romero goes out there and does struggle, I don't see it being that far-fetched of an idea to see him go back down and get back on that track of progressing through the system, building up his game mentally and physically.
No doubt, and maybe when he comes back, they maybe work a couple six-man rotation for a week to do. I'm predicting that right now because you never know with the scheduling day off here and there, it might work out. So
I haven't seen that in a while.
No, but you never know. They might do that just to try to figure
there.
It out.
Yep.
So you know how they take their time.
Sure.
We're going to be right back after this quick break.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Here we are, episode 51 of the Back in Blue video podcast. Thank you for once again joining us on our SB Nation home on YouTube. Here we are, and we are going to discuss a very hot topic this week in the world of Blue Jays and Red Sox. Clay Buchholz was straight up accused by Dirk Hayhurst of doctoring the ball, doing the old rub the arm and grease it up. And I don't know. I mean, there was photo evidence. Quote it right now because I don't know if it's if he's guilty or not. But I mean, the photo seemed to show that he had a sleeve that was greased up where he was rubbing. The other sleeve's perfectly dry. Either one of you want to join Dirk and Jack Morris for that matter and say he was cheating? Because I don't know if I can quite go that far.
I absolutely it was pretty can't fishy, go that though. Far. I can't go that far. Fishy, absolutely fishy. Fishy, definitely fishy. I think further to this, and this might not be very conducive to our discussion, but honestly, right now, I don't care. Like, I don't care.
Yeah, it's.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
This is an interesting discussion. It's not the best way to preface it. So, you boys better bring some interesting facts. But honest to God, I don't care about the.
If he's cheating, situation. Like, you don't care if he's cheating because you're okay with that, or
I would care if I saw him blatantly cheating. There's not enough evidence for me to care. That's a big difference.
Okay.
If I saw him, I'm like, you're cheating. That's a problem. That's an issue. I care.
Yeah.
Right now, I haven't seen it enough, and I don't care.
Oh, Drew, do you think he's guilty?
Yeah, he's cheating.
He called him out. I'm waiting for it.
Right away.
All right.
I saw all kinds of pictures. It's first of all, rosin's not that color. second of all, what's with his hair? Really, I mean...
What's with everyone's hair? That's what I wonder.
Is this Clay Buchholz or is this Ed Harris? It's ridiculous out there. I mean, a pitcher doesn't go like this on these two fingers, by the way. You know, the two fingers that you generally let go on the ball with, if you want to put any spin on it, it's going to be these two fingers. You don't grease those up, go to your, do all this nonsense he's doing.
But he wets his hair every inning. He pours water on his hip and he likes to wet. Isn't that legit?
Is he just a weirdo?
It's against the rules of baseball to put anything on the baseball. Yeah. It's... There it is. I mean, what more can I really say? Mm-hmm. And then to have the media attack the Blue Jays because, hey, guess who the biggest whipping boy in the Major League Baseball Association, right now, whatever you want to call it, is the Toronto Blue Jays because these guys went out and they made all the moves comparable to the Miami Marlins in 2012. So no matter what happens, if there's going to be any controversy, they're going to go with the other team because the Blue Jays are the laughing stock of the frigging league right now. And it's unfortunate. Is what it is.
It's very unfortunate.
But getting back to Buchholz, did you see his arm? Did anybody see his arm?
I did.
I mean, he's right got here. This big old dirty yellow patch, and I don't know what that is. But, you know, you tap your two fingers to it. And then, he was going to his uniform now. That's fine. You go to uniform, but what's this? Rosin? Come on.
Yeah, and like the sleeve made it pretty
My big thing, though, is if you cheat, who cheats that blatantly? I mean, come on.
That's a good question.
That is a good question. I mean, well, and for that matter, who was it? I don't want to mispronounce the name because I can't remember exactly.
Necro?
That
was cheating.
No, and there was many cheaters back then, but the reliever the next day for the Red Sox, he came out.
Oh, I can't.
And he comes out. I can't think of it. Tozawa, maybe?
Yeah.
And there you go, Tozawa. And he is going like this. Now, do you think that's maybe gamesmanship?
Because he's just
trying to play it up?
He's doing the same thing.
But when they got out of the inning, he came off and he was giving it to the crowd. Like, he was jacked. So I swear.
Who was giving it to the crowd?
The Tozawa. Like, he was yelling at the crowd. Like, he was really animated.
Yeah.
And I swear, I don't know. I think he may have just been, you know, trying to mess with everyone. I know I would have.
Yeah.
Why not? I mean, you get people talking, you get people thinking.
Yeah.
Now, aside from the Buchholz, how about we discuss Jack Morris and Dan Eckersley?
Now, this is where things get a little interesting for me, too, just listening to you guys talk about it. So I'm going to sit back and
Drew,
enjoy it.
Drew, once again, you got the stage. How do you feel about Dan Eckersley?
Well, you know, again, Toronto is your whipping boy, and anything they say obviously isn't valid because they're not winning baseball games, so let's just pick on them some more. Eckersley goes and, first of all, he calls out Dirk.
Yes.
Calls him a career minor leaguer. And, it's not wrong or anything, but at the same time, just because he's a minor leaguer.
He doesn't know anything?
Well, no. This guy pitched professional baseball, and as a fringe guy, you think he wasn't aware of the little bit of edge that you needed to do to put yourself for the edge?
Excellent
he writes
point.
About it in his book, Out of My League. For those of you who read, he talks about all the different hand creams and stuff he used to put into the bullpen bag.
Vagisil.
Sure, he likes to go on about that too, but regardless, this is a guy who's been around this in this game, and even if it's in the minor leagues or if it's in the major leagues. If anything, there's going to be more of this stuff in the minor leagues because guys are going to be, you know, obviously less. There's going to be more of this in the minor leagues because guys down there aren't going to be caught as often as they are at the major league level. So that's manure right there. And then as far as Morris goes, you know, Morris and Eckersley, these guys have a history. I don't know if a lot of people remember back then, you know, of Eckersley, nonsense. One of the first guys to go and call out Eckersley on that stuff with Jack Morris. So obviously these two are going to have a little bit of a pissing contest.
We all know Jack Morris isn't in a Hall of Famer yet, so he has no right to chime in as Eckersley, you know. And like you said, Dirk is a career minor leaguer. So
where's your foothold on this? Where are you getting this from? You're just doing it for fun? Oh, yeah, let's pick on these guys for blatant obviousness. Get off yourself.
Yeah, and I mean, we're no professionals. No. We're no analysts. We're just fans.
We're just disgruntled fans at this point. Yeah, I think we have a right to be pissed off.
Absolutely.
We do, and we have a right to comment on something as ridiculous as what Eck is saying, because, I mean, it was just nonsense. His rebuttal.
Let's grow up.
I mean, yeah, and it's one thing to protect your guy, but saying, he doesn't need to cheat. He's pitching great.
He's painting this year.
Like, what the hell do you mean he doesn't? Maybe he's pitching great because he's cheating.
The manure is flying, man.
Yeah, it's true. I mean,
but after all this, all I can think of is a guy like Dirk Hayhurst back in his minor league days at Shoppers picking up Vagisil.
Thank you very much.
Being at the till and somebody being like, "Oh, I'm picking up something for the wife, eh?" Yeah, the wife.
Looking over his shoulder for umpires and officials, right?
There's that. What we talked about too is also Morris's comment to Salta Lamacchio, which is one of the most nails things I've ever heard in my life. You got Morris coming up the guy. You know, this isn't my first expletive rodeo, and then just walking away from him. Yeah. You want to send a message. Hilarious. It's hilarious. Yeah. And for those of you who've seen Morris nowadays, I mean, he's still a hulking figure and everything, but walking up to Salta Lamacchio and just getting in his face and telling him off and walking away, that's hilarious.
That's really funny.
Yeah, I wish I could have been there for that.
Sports world's heating up. I got to bring up the fact my boy Brendan Pruss called the coach of Ottawa Senators.
The fat, over there.
Beady-eyed walrus.
Yeah.
So the sports world poo is flying.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I'd love to see it, but I mean, real quick, back to Buchholz. It'll be interesting to see his next start.
Let's see his next start. Know? Let's see what his arm looks like then. And let's see if any of the opposing team, I'm not too sure who they're facing, but let's see if they go after him and, you know, got someone looking at his arm.
I don't think anyone's going to say anything yet, even if it's there, because I think they're going to hang on till, when it matters.
Yeah.
Right? And they're not going to worry about it now in May. Mm-hmm. You know, wait till September rolls around, October. If anything greasy's going on there, literally.
Greasy.
Yeah, yeah.
Literally. He's going to get caught, you know, so it'll be interesting to see what happens, and can't wait for it. Take one more break here, and we'll be right back. Welcome back. Here we are, Back in Blue video podcast, segment number 3, as we say. Interesting topic lately. Second base. Turris has been hitting fairly well the last couple days, but there's been a lot of discussion. Do we bring up Jim Nagerich from Buffalo? Boys, chime in. Nagerich is hitting 420. I believe he's still leading the minor leagues in AAA, International League. I guess that's what I should say. In batting average, and it's not all about batting average, but he's looking good. He's 29-year-old career minor leaguer, never got a shot at the big leagues. Does he deserve a shot just because he's hitting well? Or should we stick with the fact that Izzy is a career big leaguer and he's going to, you know, come around?
With what he's doing and his age and the grind he's on, absolutely deserves a shot, without a doubt.
Can't argue
should
that.
They pull the trigger on it soon? I pretty strongly don't think that they should. I'm thinking around give this situation about a month.
Fair enough, another month. Drew, do you think, like like I said, a career minor leaguer that he's playing this well now. I mean, he's a career 301 average in the minors, and so clearly that's not going to translate to the bigs. He's going to drop a bit there. His fielding percentage, you mentioned, is not too spiffy, but he's been playing better lately, this season at least. Do you think he deserves a shot?
Well, like, the basic argument here is you've got a tandem right now of a couple of guys playing second base for you, mostly Asturias right now,
yep,
who just aren't getting the job done offensively, and for the most part, save for this week,
one real nice play today,
yeah, but not getting the job done defensively. And really, if you look at this team, there's a lot of holes, but this one seems to be a glaring one. Negrich, like you mentioned, a career 300 batting average in the minor leagues. You can't really translate that to an MLB question mark, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, you're not going to. But yeah, exactly.
But really, he's a guy that does deserve a shot. And again, how long can you really? It's like Henry Blanco and Josh Tolley, because Josh Tolley's turning the cover off the ball down there too.
Another good debate.
How long can you keep these guys up at the major league level and have them not produce consistently when you have guys that are down on your farm team producing? And again, at MILB statistics and everything, it's going to be a translation. But how long can you keep these guys hurting your club when you got guys down there that could potentially better your club? And again, if it doesn't work out, then you send them back down. But really, with the state of the things the way they are right now, I don't really see it being that far-fetched of an idea to bring Negrich up. And again, a lot of people are kind of jumping on this whole Negrich bandwagon because they're seeing what
obviously
he's doing. And,
yeah,
and with Buffalo being so close to Toronto, a lot more people are paying more attention than they would have last year.
Yeah.
But really, he's a guy that I think deserves a shot. And if Asturias continues to get on base at a 221 clip like he's been doing, I mean, you have to switch this out.
It's fair enough, but I mean, what do? You don't just trade him, because who's going to trade him for anything?
Or
who's
going
to take? Yeah, you can't just get rid of him right now. I mean, it's early in the year. Teams aren't really looking to deal. AA, I think he'd have a hard time getting any kind of value back. I mean, it would be mostly a dump, legit. And what, do you dump a guy and then just hope that this guy translates to the big leagues?
Well,
or do you have him come up, struggle for a couple months, and then send him down? Reyes comes back, Kawasaki moves to second.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of pieces to the puzzle, obviously, more so than, and even like you said, Bonifacio. So I don't know. I don't think we'll be seeing Jim up too soon.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if he's going to hit at his 420 clip still.
He's definitely not going to hit at 420
in
major
come
leagues.
On.
But at the
same
time,
in the minor leagues even. I don't think he's going to hit over 400 in the minors all year.
No, not at all.
He's going to even out soon, and I bet you it happens in the next couple of weeks, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if it happens in the minors, it would happen in the majors, right? So
I think sometimes, I don't think any of you guys hit this point, that sometimes you just got to rock the boat a little bit. And if you have open moves to do this, that doesn't affect your roster that much. But making these moves, sometimes rocking that boat might give other guys sparks, like Asturias, Bonifacio, or something like that, to bring this guy up for a couple weeks. So I was just thinking that as you guys were discussing it.
Yeah, and I don't know if you want to rock the boat of a team that's dysfunctional,
a little fragile,
to quote R.A. Dickey.
It's tricky.
You know, not dysfunctional in the clubhouse, but apparently on the field. And there was also, real quick, there was a quote from, or something from Heyman, John Heyman today, where there's a clubhouse source saying the Jays apparently have some selfishness issues. Did you see that? Did you hear about that?
Here we go.
I read the article. He actually posted the article.
I didn't see that. Okay, so real quick, what was that?
I was just,
yes, sir.
It's a team that's struggling, and it's media. I'm not going to try to call out the media on this, but they're going to jump on whatever the hot story is right now.
Yeah.
And if you have a team that's struggling this bad, and you're going to throw something out like say even R.A. Dickey's dysfunctional comment, or the team's selfishness, which I think was punctuated by Cabrera trying to take second base yesterday's game.
Yeah. That was disgusting.
It's just going to be a hot topic, and people are going to read it right now. That's all you can
absolutely
really chalk this up to. Read into it what you will.
Nobody has answers, so people are kind of making up answers.
That's why not.
Good call. That's exactly right. That wraps up Back in Blue 51, folks. Take care.